Ciao, qui Gio Fumagalli, fondatore ed editore dietro a Ibex Edizioni, e questo video che stai per vedere è il secondo episodio dell'intervento che Eric Schmidt, il CEO, l'ex CEO di Google, ha rilasciato all'Università di Stanford, ha tenuto all'Università di Stanford. Il primo, se non l'hai ancora visto, ti invito caldamente a vederlo perché è molto interessante e ha ricevuto veramente un sacco di commenti, like, interazioni. Lo troverai in descrizione, lo troverai pinnato nei commenti. Questo è il secondo episodio e probabilmente il terzo episodio sarà anche l'ultimo, nel senso che andremo a condensare tutta quanta l'ultima parte all'interno di un unico altro video che dovremmo pubblicare sempre nel giro di una settimana, 10 giorni. Di cosa si parla in questo episodio? Si parla di fondi e intelligenza artificiale, di applicazioni pratiche all'intelligenza artificiale e di tutta una serie di sviluppi su un tema che in questo momento probabilmente molti di noi faticano ancora a comprendere del tutto. Per cui io ti consiglio di guardare questo video, se ti piace l'argomento iscriverti al canale, di guardare un po' anche gli altri video che trovi sul canale, perché sono tutti quanti video abbastanza interessanti su tematiche molto attuali, devo dire. E nulla, piazza un like, piazza un bel commento e goditi il video. Ciao!
I want to switch to a little bit of a philosophical question. So there was an article that you and Henry Kissinger and Dan Huttenlocher wrote last year about the nature of knowledge and how it's evolving. I had a discussion the other night about this as well. So for most of history, humans sort of had a mystical understanding of the universe. And then there's the scientific revolution and the Enlightenment. And in your article, you argue that now these models are becoming so complicated and difficult to understand that we don't really know what's going on in them. I'll take a quote from Richard Feynman. He says, "What I cannot create, I do not understand." I saw this quote the other day. But now people are creating things they do not that they can create, but they don't really understand what's inside of them. Is the nature of knowledge changing in a way? Are we going to have to start just taking the word for these models without them being able to explain it to us?
The analogy I offer is to teenagers. If you have a teenager, you know they're human, but you can't quite figure out what they're thinking. But somehow we've managed in society to adapt to the presence of teenagers, right? And they eventually grow out of it. And I'm just serious. So it's probably the case that we're going to have knowledge systems that we cannot fully characterize, but we understand their boundaries, right? We understand the limits of what they can do. And that's probably the best outcome we can get.
Do you think we'll understand the limits?
We'll get pretty good at it. The consensus of my group that meets on every week is that eventually the way you'll do this, it's called so-called adversarial AI, is that there will actually be companies that you will hire and pay to break your AI system.
Like red
so,
teams.
So it'll be the red, instead of human red teams, which is what they do today, you'll have whole companies and a whole industry of AI systems whose jobs are to break the existing AI systems and find their vulnerabilities, especially the knowledge that they have that we can't figure out. That makes sense to me. It's also a great project for you here at Stanford, because if you have a graduate student who has to figure out how to attack one of these large models and understand what it does, that is a great skill to build the next generation. So it makes sense to me that the two will travel together.
All right, let's take some questions from the student. There's one right there in the back. Just say your name.
You just mentioned adversarial AI, and I'm wondering if you could elaborate on that more. So this seems to be, besides, obviously, compute will increase and you can get more performant models, but is getting them to do what you want issue?
Well, you have to assume that the current hallucination problems become less, right, in as the technology gets better and so forth. I'm not suggesting it goes away. And then you also have to assume that there are tests for efficacy. So there has to be a way of knowing that the thing succeeded. So in the example that I gave of the TikTok competitor, and by the way, I was not arguing that you should illegally steal everybody's music. What you would do if you're a Silicon Valley entrepreneur, which hopefully all of you will be, is if it took off, then you'd hire a whole bunch of lawyers to go clean the mess up, right? But if nobody uses your product, it doesn't matter that you stole all the content. And do not quote me. Right.
You're on camera.
Yeah, that's right. But you see my point. In other words, Silicon Valley will run these tests and clean up the mess. And that's typically how those things are done. So my own view is that you'll see more and more performative systems with even better tests and eventually adversarial tests and that'll keep it within a box. The technical term is called chain of thought reasoning. And people believe that in the next few years, you'll be able to generate 1,000 steps of chain of thought reasoning, right? Do this, do this. It's like building recipes, mm-hmm. right? That the recipes run the recipe and you can actually test that it produced the correct outcome. And that's how the system will work. Yes, sir.
In general, you seem super positive about the potential for AI's progress. And I'm curious, like, what do you think is going to drive that? Is it just more compute? Is it more data? Is it fundamental architectural shifts?
Yes. The amounts of money being thrown around are mind-boggling. And I essentially invest in everything because I can't figure out who's going to win. And the amounts of money that are following me are so large. I think some of it is because the early money has been made and the big money people who don't know what they're doing have to have an AI component. And everything is now an AI investment, so they can't tell the difference. I define AI as learning systems that actually learn. So I think that's one of them. The second is that there are very sophisticated new algorithms that are sort of post-transformers. My friend, my collaborator for a long time, has invented a new non-transformer architecture. There's a group that I'm funding in Paris that has claims to have done the same thing. So there's enormous invention there, a lot of things at Stanford. The final thing is that there is a belief in the market that the invention of intelligence has infinite return. So let's say you put $50 billion of capital into a company. You have to make an awful lot of money from intelligence to pay that back. So it's probably the case that we'll go through some huge investment bubble and then it'll sort itself out. That's always been true in the past, and it's likely to be true here.
And what you said earlier was you think that the leaders are pulling away from
right
the rest.
Right now. And this is a really, question is following. There's a company called Mistral in France. They've mm-hmm. done a really good job. And I'm obviously an investor. They have produced their second version. Their model is likely to be closed because it's so expensive. Mm-hmm. They need revenue and they can't give their model away. So this open source versus closed source debate in our industry is huge. And my entire career was based on people being willing to share software in open source. Everything about me is open source. Much of Google's underpinnings were open source. Everything I've done technically. And yet it may be that the capital costs, which are so immense, fundamentally changes how software is built. You and I were talking, my own view of software programmers is that software programmers' productivity will at least double. Mm-hmm. There are three or four software companies that are trying to do that. I've invested in all of them in the spirit. And they're all trying to make software programmers more productive. The most interesting one that I just met with is called Augment. And I always think of an individual programmer. And they said, that's not our target. Our target are these 100-person software programming teams on millions of lines of code where nobody knows what's going on. Mm. Well, that's a really good AI thing. Will they make money? I hope so.
At the very beginning, you mentioned that there's the combination of the context window expansion, the agents, and the text to action is going to have unimaginable impacts. First of all, why is the combination important? And second of all, I know that, you know, you're not like a crystal ball and you can't necessarily tell the future, but why do you think it's beyond anything that we could imagine?
I think largely because the context window allows you to solve the problem of recency. The current models take a year to train, roughly six months of preparation, 6 months of training, 6 months of fine tuning. So they're always out of date. Context window, you can feed what happened. Like you can ask it questions about the Hamas-Israel war, right, in a context. That's very powerful. It becomes current like Google. In the case of agents, I'll give you an example. I set up a foundation, which is funding a nonprofit, which starts, I don't know if there's chemists in the room, I don't really understand chemistry. There's a tool called ChemCrow, which was an LLM-based system that learned chemistry. And what they do is they run it to generate chemistry hypotheses about proteins. And then they have a lab which runs the tests overnight, and then it learns. That's a huge accelerant in chemistry, material science, and so forth. So that's an agent model. And I think the text to action can be understood by just having a lot of cheap programmers, right? And I don't think we understand what happens, and this is, again, your area of expertise, what happens when everyone has their own programmer? And I'm not talking about turning on and off the lights. You know, I imagine, another example, for some reason you don't like Google. So you say, build me a Google competitor. Yeah, you personally, you don't build me a Google competitor, search the web, build a UI, make a good copy, add generative AI in an interesting way, do it in 30 seconds, and see if it works, right? So a lot of people believe that the incumbents, including Google, are vulnerable to this kind of an attack. Now, we'll see.